Verse 25 of the 15th chapter of 2 Samuel says on this wise, "And the king said unto Zadok, carry back the ark of God into the city. If I shall find favor in the eyes of the Lord, he will bring me again and show me both it and his habitation. But if he thus say, I have no delight in thee, behold, here I am, let him do to me as seemeth good to him." In other words, he's saying, if the Lord finds favor with me, he'll bring me back to where I started, to where I belong, and to his habitation. But if there is no necessity for me, here am I exposed to my enemy, and let them do what profiteth it to them. I want to cross-reference and use as a secondary text tonight Psalm the 41st chapter. And I believe for somebody that's been going through some stuff, this will be a poster scripture for your future tonight. And I just need a praise to give God glory when you hear this. Hallelujah. Psalm the 41st chapter and verse number 2 says, "The Lord will preserve him and keep him alive. And he shall be blessed upon the earth." Not only is he going to let you survive, but he's going to use you. "He'll be blessed on the earth, and thou wilt not deliver him unto the will of his enemies." You ought to just tell somebody, the Lord will preserve you. Come on, tell somebody else, the Lord will preserve you. Yeah, you won't die like this. The Lord will preserve you and keep you alive. Tonight, I want you to help me preach from a declaration. The Lord put these words in my spirit, and I want you to just tell somebody. I know you're tired of your neighbor already, but just look at somebody and tell them, neighbor, God rewrote your story. Yeah. That's what we came to preach tonight. God rewrote your story. If you believe that, give God a praise right there. God rewrote your story. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. God rewrote your story. Here in our text tonight, and I promise we'll be very quick, here in Psalm 41, initially we find David as he is reflecting on the keeping power of God. For many of us, we read this chapter, and those who have studied it, we see it as just means of inspiration or meditation. However, we find that it is very imperative that we see the fullness of David's sentiments, because David is not just speaking by faith. David is not just speaking to us concerning a matter that he anticipates would happen, but rather David is speaking from a place of experience. He's speaking as he's recalling a particular time in his life, which can be found around this 15th chapter of Samuel. For we see here that in this 15th chapter and the surrounding, that David is faced with grave opposition by his deceptive son, Absalom. Somebody shout Absalom. Amen. He's dealing with the opposition from his son Absalom. The Bible tells us that Absalom, after being back in Jerusalem for a few years, seeks to capture the throne of David, his father. We are to take note that he had not seen David's face. He had not been in the presence of his father, nor has he heard his voice for some time. Perhaps he had not even seen the productivity of David in the kingdom of Israel. However, it is Absalom's aim to pursue rulership. And so Absalom sends for Joab, and after several attempts, the Bible says that Absalom sends for Joab's field to be set on fire. And finally, Absalom gets the attention of Joab, the Bible says, and needs him to be a gateway and an avenue to the house of David. Isn't it something how the adversary, he'll do the best he can when he knows that you're on the Lord's side, when he knows that you have the heart of God? He says, I can't get directly to them, so what I'll do is I'll try to take a scenic route to get into their life. I'll try to go through that one connection. I'll try to go through that one person in their surrounding, in their influence, in their network to see if I can distract their focus from the things of God. And so Absalom resembles a lot of the enemies that we face even in the 21st century. For we know here that we've seen and we've grown in the grace of God, and because we found favor with the Lord, because we found favor with God, the enemy knows that he does not have direct access, but rather he'll say, I'll try my best to go around the circumference of their life. Look at the similarity, because it reminds me of Job, in fact, because the Bible says that Satan, he's trying to get a hold of somebody to attack. God says, have you considered my servant Job? You know what the story says. God says Job is a righteous man. He's a man of God. He escheweth evil. He's one that has been coming to revival every night. He's been coming to Bible class. He's listened to every message. He's been at prayer service, every service, every time that the church lights are open. He's been living right. He is the one that I'm planning to use in this day. Have you considered my servant Job? Satan says, well, I would touch him. I would try to kill him, but somehow you've put a hedge around his life. Can I just insert this here parenthetically, that the reason why you have not died where you are, the reason why the enemy has not taken your mind, is because God has already put a hedge of protection around your life. All right. Yes, I know you don't went to the mountain, and I know you're a little sleepy here, but I need somebody to pray with me tonight. You ought to give God glory every now and then, not just because that you're in the church setting, but now give God glory because you know that what could have killed you, God blocked it. What could have taken your mind, God blocked it. Rather, but not only did God block it, but God even stopped the chance of the adversary. Come on, let's read our Bible. When the enemy shall have come in like a flood. Yeah. The Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against it. You know, Pastor Long, what I've got excited about with that scripture is that the Lord told us that not only does that mean that God would raise up a defense against the adversary, but now what that lets me know is that when the enemy comes in like a flood, God has a way of exceeding the actions of the adversary. And I wonder if there's anybody in the room tonight that says, Lord, I'm grateful. Lord, I'm thankful that when the enemy tried his hardest, when the adversary tried his best, it did not even compare to the glory that you would reveal in me. In other words, eyes have not seen, neither has ears heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men. Somebody shout hallelujah. Oh, yes, hearts of men, what God has in store for you. And so we've seen it pretty often how certain situations, thank God that we have obtained victory over some enemies that we have fought and some giants that we have slain. Somehow they have already been defeated, yet the enemy uses that one device, that one person, that Joab, if you will, to try and capture our focus on the things of God. As gifted as you are, as anointed as you may be, we can be real with ourselves and say, yes, Lord, I still deal with some real life situations. I wish I had some help in here tonight. Yes, as much as well as you can shout, I still have some headaches and heartaches. And as the old church would say, time is filled with swift transitions, Lord. But I'm so glad tonight that even though time is filled with those swift transitions, I can find God telling me what he told Abram in the 12th chapter of Genesis. He said, though you've lost some things, go into a land that I will show thee, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I'll make your name great. Lord, I feel an interruption from the Holy Ghost because the Lord told me to tell about 10 young people in the church tonight that if you just hold on to God, I'll make your name great, Lord. But not great in your own might, but I'll make your name great for my name's sake. Lord, is there anybody in the church tonight that says, I'm ready for God to use me better than he's ever used me before? I'm ready for God to do a new thing
thing in me. I told you earlier in our worship that behold, I'll do a new thing, God says. Now shall it spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in your desert. It's interesting how the Bible says that he'll make a way in the wilderness. Our wilderness is a place that's desolate and easy to get lost in. But he says, I'll make a way where it's easy to get lost. But not only will I make a way where it's easy to get lost, but I'll make rivers in the desert. What is the desert? The desert is a dry place. So God is the only one that can give you an opposite outcome in the situation that you're in. God is the only one that says, when you are condemned, I'll raise you up. When you are fought against, I'll fight your battles. When you have no defense, I'll be your shield and buckler. When you are without, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. I need somebody that's ready for God to do the opposite in their favor, to jump on your feet and give God a praise on credit for what you cannot even see yet. Believe God to do another power. Somebody shout hallelujah. Somebody shout hallelujah tonight. And so we must understand here that we don't need to be discouraged when we don't understand the cares of this life. For all it is what the Bible tells us. Look at what Jesus says in the Gospel of Luke. Jesus says unto Simon Peter, you know what the Bible says, Simon, Simon, Satan desires to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But he said, no, I'm not going to make sure you get a new suit. I'm not going to make sure you have a nice church hat or the best shoes in town. But I prayed for you that your faith fell not. Lord, have mercy. I prayed for you that you wouldn't stop believing in me. I prayed that you would not lose your hope and confidence in me. When thou art converted, when you come to yourself and realize that I was there all the time, strengthen the brethren. I come to tell somebody tonight that the opposition you face, and I promise I'm going to get to my text table, the opposition that you face tonight is not just for you. Oh Lord, have mercy. But rather, God says, I'm letting you go through this because there's going to come a season where I'll need you to minister to that need, Lord. Yes, I'll let you deal with the temptation. But there have no temptation taking you such as is common to man. But God is faithful to bring you to a place that you can come out of it. And the only way to come out of it and really claim victory is to come out of it and have a way of bringing others with you. Come on, ask Paul, what did they do? They prayed and sang praises in the prison, and suddenly the open the jail cells, not only for them to get out, but your Bible says that every man's bands were loose. I wonder if there's anybody here tonight that's been fighting a giant that seems too big for you, that's been in a prison that's been confining you. Is there anybody that'll give God praise as if everybody connected to you was being freed when God let you out? How would you praise him if your family depended on your deliverance? Open up your mouth and show it to God. Glory to God. Somebody clap those hands tonight and shout hallelujah. And so we must see here and take note of how imperative it is for us to avoid the risk of being connected to the wrong people. That's what the Lord told me to tell somebody in prayer. He said, in order for me to give you the expected end, you've got to not only watch what I'm doing and what your adversaries are doing, but you've got to watch who you surround yourself with. Lord, I'm so glad that most of the house is young people, because you know how fickle we become. We feed to who validates us. We feed to who tickles our fancy, who tells us how good we are at what we do. But I come to tell tell you now, it's a detrimental thing to put your confidence in those who temporarily clap when you win. Because there's some folk, Lord, I feel like preaching tonight, there's some folk that are clap until you win a little more than they seem to. Oh, but I come to tell you now that even when you exceed those who are around you, God has a way of causing all of that to blot away. Oh, Lord, have mercy. God has a way for causing them to fall at your right hand and letting you keep going higher. When my father and mother forsake me, then the Lord shall take me up. You'd be surprised tonight, church, who will live to see you lose. Lord, have mercy, God. They don't want to see you make it. They don't want to see you survive through this. They're used to the old you. They're used to the strongholds that have been oppressed on your life. They're used to the pain that was caused in front of your heart, that was caused in front of your life. They're used to the relationship that had you bound. They're used to that spouse or that significant other that said this, that, and so forth about you. But I'm so glad that if Christ has made us free, you shall be free indeed. Free from the opinions of others. Free from that relationship. Free from that soul tie. Free from that oppression. I need a free church to give God a free praise, because he's breaking the addiction you had to your past. Lord, I need you to help me preach tonight and grab a neighbor by the hand and tell them, neighbor, guess what? God canceled the subscription to my past. Lord, I feel the Holy Ghost here. God canceled my subscription. I'm not entangled in that anymore. It's in the past. And when God forgot about it, I forgot about it. God, he said, I know the plans that I have for you to prosper you and to give you an expected income. Clap those hands and shout, yes, Lord. Hallelujah to God. And so people sometimes live to see you lose, and they have the aim to replace you. Oh, but I come against that spirit of sabotage, that spirit that says that you are not good enough. I come against that spirit that says you ought to stay right on that pew and not go for what God called you to be. But if God called you to be an evangelist, it's time for you to evangelize. I'm not talking about preaching. I'm talking about winning some souls. Well, aren't you tired? Let me just put that there. Aren't you tired of coming to church and it just being saved? Just being saints in there? A church full of saints becomes a complacent church too long. But I'm looking for a day where we can go across the nation and find our church filled with hungry souls saying, what must I do to be saved? And our only answer will be, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I unto thee. In the name of Jesus, come out of that place that you've been desolate in. Rise up and walk into the newness of life. Somebody shout hallelujah. And so now we've got to evaluate, because look at the text here. David finally comes in contact with Absalom, and I could imagine in my sanctified mind that David probably saw him and said, what in the world are you doing here? Where are you coming from? He knows how manipulative his son Absalom can be. In other words, can I just say it the way the old song said, who let the dogs out? I could imagine that's what he wondered when Absalom walked into his courts. Lord, who in the world sent you here? Oh, Lord, have mercy. And the Bible says that David, when he saw his son, the son came and arrived to David and kissed him. Hallelujah to God. Isn't it something how throughout the word of God, a betrayal was always initiated by a kiss? Lord, you got to watch who you let kiss you. Lord, you better hear me tonight. Because who kisses you may kill you. Oh, Lord. Y'all don't want to shout off of that. It's all right. You shout later or you shouted enough already. Oh, but if you watch who will kiss you, then maybe you will save your future. Let me just translate it in modern terms. You better watch who you get in relationships with. Because you may be married. Come on, brothers. You may be marrying your Delilah, Lord. You may be marrying that attack that's been the adversary's been waiting to use. Come on, sisters, you too. Yeah. Yeah, you like how he looks in that suit. You like how much gear he has. Listen, sister. He may be the wrong one. Hallelujah to God. He may be the one meant for your demise. But I come to tell you, if God be for you, you better disregard those who may be against you. Because God said, I'm able to keep you in the hollow of my hand. And when the fullness of time comes, I'll send you who belongs with you. Lord, I wish somebody to get happy there. Yes, you like the testimonies of cars and houses. But God says, I'm about to give you people for your life. If you need God to give you the right connections, I dare to declare it tonight. Said, God, I'm ready for you to do it in my life. Yeah, oh, glory to God. How do you know when they're the right connection? Because your prayer relationship will be just as strong as your intimate relation, Lord. They don't believe me, Lord. Next time, for some of you that's dating somebody, I need you to evaluate. Take this home with you. Evaluate the relationship of prayer that y'all both have. Lord, if y'all can't pray together, if y'all can't get in the face of God together with one accord, Lord, sister, they're not the one. Brother, they're not the one. But can you pray with me in my low place? Can you plead the blood when I can't see the devil on his way? Can you rebuke sickness when the ailment has come to my body? How can you handle the attack on my life? I need you to grab somebody by the hand and look at him and say, neighbor, can you stand the rain? Are you ready to go through the hail? Are you ready to go through the high water that it takes for me to be this anointed? Are you ready to go through the pain it takes for my purpose? If you're ready, I believe God will do it for both of us. Now, if you need God to give you the right connection, lift up your hand and say, God, I'm isolating myself so that you can do the right thing in me. Now, give God a praise with the fruit of your lips. Glory to God. Hallelujah. And I come to prophesy to somebody that if you get around the right people, they'll understand that it doth not yet appear what you shall be. But when you see him, I'm not just talking about the rapture now. I'm talking about your fulfillment in the earth to do what God called you to do. When you see him, when you're exposed to his power, when you're walking in his presence, and you're living in his presence, you shall be like him. Glory to God. For you shall be exposed and see him as he is. And so we must hasten to the text here. We see that Absalom in this 15th chapter, he's preparing the chariots and horses. He makes arrangements to go to Syria, the Bible says. And after speaking with David, he goes on to Hebron. But then he's noticed something here in the text, for the Bible says that Absalom sends spies through Israel. And he says that when you hear the trumpet, the time of attack has come. Would you believe that tonight, even while you're in the presence of God, the enemy has spies. Lord have mercy. Ready to take you out. Has spies trying to get a hold of your focus. That's that temptation that fights you when you leave the house of God. God, to the enemy are sending spies to take you out. But I come to tell somebody that you've got to assert yourself in the power that God gave you. If I didn't come to do anything else tonight, I came to remind you of the dominion you have with God. I come to remind you that you have power over the enemy. You have power power over the spy that said that you couldn't make it. And you know what? I come to tell you tonight that you've got to assert yourself in the place and shame that spy. You can get a good look at me, but you have to watch me be blessed in the face of you and your imps. Lord, how about no look at David? He said, thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. I come to tell you tonight that you don't have to entertain your enemies. God will invite them to watch you get blessed. And though they're invited, they can't sit down at the table. That table is reserved just for you. The table's reserved because you've been holy, because you've been righteous, because you've been faithful. I need somebody that says, God, I've been faithful. I need you to bless me. I need you to give God praise, because God says, not only will I bless you, but I'll let your enemies serve you your blessing. I need somebody that's ready for God to make your enemies your waiters, to jump on your feet and open up your mouth and say, this praise is to remind the enemy that what the devil meant for evil, God is turning around for my good. High five somebody and tell them it's turning around. Hallelujah to God. It's turning around, and now you'll be the featured attraction in this next season of your life. I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed in you. And so we find him that David becomes aware of the attack. Hallelujah to God. And he becomes aware and creates a strategy to escape the attack of his son Absalom. But the text here, it teaches us something profound, for we find that David finds confidence in one thing, and one thing only. The Bible says that he finds confidence in the presence of God. Glory to God. We find that David, he finds solace, he finds relief when he gets into the place that God called him to be. And what is that place? That place is a place of worship. That place is a place of magnifying him. That's why David said, I'll bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. He's not saying that just in anticipation, but he's saying that from a place that he's been in. He says, I've been in that place where my life has been under attack. But I find confidence in the promise of God. I find confidence in the word that God gave me. For the Bible shows us that he found the Levites and he brought them with him. And the Levites bore the Ark of the Covenant. Somebody shout, the Ark of the Covenant. The Bible says that the Levites, he sent for them to bring the Ark of the Covenant. And this brings us back here where David says, if I shall find favor with God, I'm making a comeback. And the Lord sent me to tell somebody that has been deceived, that's been blamed and framed, that's been sabotaged and manipulated. The Lord told me to tell you that just because you're under attack does not mean you don't have a defense. But your defense is in the name of the Lord. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run in and they are safe. And God's saying tonight that as long as you keep the ark with you, I won't let you die, but rather I'll rewrite the story. I'm ready to have a little church here, Jahir. I need you to help me preach tonight and tell your neighbor, tell a neighbor, you know what will save your life? It is the fact that you are a worshiper. Y'all are helping me preach. I said, tell them, say, neighbor, you know what will save your life? Tell them it's the fact that you are a worshiper. Your praise will save your life. Your praise will get the devil off your back. Your praise will get the devil off your money. Your praise will get the devil off your future. I wonder, is there anybody that says, I've been under attack for a long time now. I've been fighting this same adversary season after season, night after night, revival after revival. But God said, I am able to blot out your adversary. Shout yes, Lord. Shout yes, Lord. And so the Bible says that David found confidence in the Ark of the Covenant. And that's what God sent me tonight to tell you, that when your heart is overwhelmed, find your confidence in the presence of God. I need you to do something that's radical for a moment here. I want every worshiper and every praiser to get on your feet across this sanctuary. And for the next 30 seconds, I need you to use what God gave you to win the battle. You're saying, well, preacher, what did God give me? God gave you a spirit of worship. God gave you your hands to lift up toward heaven. God gave you your mouth to open and declare, let everything that hath breath praise him. When you praise him, the devil has got to back up. When you praise him, the cancer has to run out. When you praise him, everything that's had you tempted has to run away. Everything that's been in your bloodline has a curse, has to be broken. I need the redeemed David's in the room that say, I see my Absalom trying to kill me, but I've got the glory over my life. I see my enemies standing up in my face, but I've got the glory over my life. Yes, they tried to turn me around, but too late. I've got the glory over my life, and the glory won't let me quit. The glory won't let me backslide. The glory won't let me turn around. The glory won't let me fall. For they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on the wings as eagles. They'll run and not be weary. They'll walk and not faint. I need somebody that has the ark on their life, that has the glory on their life, to move from where you are and give God a radical praise. Give God a praise. Get out of your seat and say, I'm moving away from the spies. I'm getting away from the sabotage. I'm getting away from the manipulation. But God said that he'll hide me in the secret place of his tabernacle. The devil, he tried it, but God, he turned it. The devil had an outcome, but God is not a man that he shall lie. Neither is he the son of man that he would repent. If he spoken it, shall he not do it? If he said it, he will bring it to pass. How do I know? Because he wrote it. He wrote it that way. I will not be killed because God rewrote the story. I will not lose my mind because God rewrote the story. Grab a neighbor by the hand and and tell a neighbor, aren't you glad that God rewrote your story? You should have died, but God wrote that part out. You should have committed suicide, but God wrote that part out. You should be dead, sleeping in your grave, but God wrote that part out. And I hear the words of Disney, and they lived happily ever after. I need you to help me preach and tell somebody, you shall live and not die, and declare the works of the Lord. You will outlive what the devil said about you. You will outlive the diagnosis. You will outlive the pain of your past. You will outlive the suicide on your mind. Open your mouth and give God glory. Somebody shout, yes, Lord. Somebody shout, yes, Lord. And I hear the Lord saying, he said, consider the end of our text. But we find that the Bible says that Absalom finally dies. I need you to hear this. Absalom, he dies at the end of our text. But you want to know how he dies. And this is for a praiser that I really believe it. He dies at the hand of Joab. Lord have mercy. What am I telling you? What I said at the beginning, Joab was used by Absalom to kill David. But somehow at the end of the story, Joab killed Absalom. I stopped by the church tonight to tell the praiser that if you give God glory, I'll use the devil's tactics to rip back fire. If you praise me, I'll cause what the enemy try to use to steal your joy to take him out. If you praise me, I'll take the lion's sword and cut his head off. Where are the praisers that said, God, rewrite my story, change my outlook, change my perspective, change my productivity? If you believe it, give God praise. Like the devil's plan just backfired, just backfired, just backfired. How would you praise him when the enemy missed again? How would you praise when the enemy lied again? How would you praise when the enemy was wrong again? Give God glory. Give God glory. I need you to turn your praise to another level. When I count to three, I want you to move and go tell seven people, Satan was wrong again. One, two, three, go tell them, Satan was wrong again. Nobody gave him the memo that God rewrote the story. Nobody gave him the memo that God rewrote the story. He wrote youth to be healthy. He wrote for you to be delivered. He wrote for you to be set free. Somebody clap those hands. The story has been changed. The story has been changed. If any man be in Christ, everything is new. The story has changed for you to live. be happy. I said live, be happy. I said live, be happy. You better catch on to it. Put a praise on it. You ought to live and be happy. Stop being depressed. Stop being discouraged. It's time to live and be happy. It's time to live and be happy. Grab somebody and dance with them. Tell a neighbor, it's time to live. Be happy. Be happy. Be happy. Be happy. Joy unspeakable and full of glory. Be happy. Turned it. He turned it. I need you to put your feet on the floor if you declare it. He turned it. He turned it. He turned it. He turned it. My mourning into dancing. My sorrow into joy. He turned it. 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 I want to stop until he turns it. I will stop until he turns it. He turned it. Everything about me is getting better. Everything. I need you to put a dance on it to show the devil everything in my life just made an acceleration. God! It didn't work the last time. But God said all things are working together. This time, it's got to work. This time, it's got to get better. This time, go back and believe again. Let God rewrite your story. Yeah, I made some mistakes. Yes, I sinned. Yes, I didn't please God. But he wrote that part out. Yes, I fought for him. Yes, I've been to blame for it. But he wrote that part out. Yes, I didn't think the way that I should. But he wrote that part out. He rewrote the story. He rewrote the story. My temptation is not in it no longer. My sin is no longer in it. If the Son shall therefore make you free, ye shall be free indeed, free indeed. There's been a plot twist to your situation. There's been a plot twist to your situation. There's been a plot twist to your situation. There's been a plot twist. There's been a plot twist. There's been a plot twist. I dare you to praise. Without the music, I need you to put a dance right here. Put your dance right there. You don't need the music. All you need is a memory of what you should be, of how you were. Just put a feet on the floor. Let them get their praise in. You get your praise in. You don't need a track. You don't need a motif. All you need is a memory of what you used to be. All you need is a flashback of what God did to bring you out. Jesus went to Calvary to save a wretch like you and me. This praise is personal. You don't know what I used to be. This praise is personal. You don't know what attack hit me on the way to church tonight. This one's personal. You don't know how I should have died while I was in service. This praise is personal. It's personal. It's not for you. This is for me. I've got a testimony. God has been good to me. God has been merciful. When I think of the goodness of Jesus, did more than I ever expected. You 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 did more than I ever expected. Only God can do it. 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 Only God can save. Only God can heal. Only God can do it. Only God can do it. Do it. Only God can do it. Only God can heal. Heal my troubled mind. Only God can do it. Only God can save. Save my weary soul. Only God can do it. He's the only one. He's the only one. He's the only one that could rewrite my story. Only God can do it. Only God can do it. Only God can do it. Give him praise only. Give him glory only. Give him honor only. He alone is worthy. He alone is worthy. Only God can do it. Only God can do it. Look back over your life and find one reason. Find one thing that only God can do. Find one thing only God can do. Only God can do it. Only God can do it. Everywhere, lift those hands and give God glory. Come on, give him glory. Give him a prayer of thanksgiving. Lord, I thank you for rewriting the story. Lord, I thank you for changing the outcome. Lord, I thank you for giving me a yes when the devil said no. When my enemies came in to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. God, I thank you. Come on, open up your mouth without the music and worship God. Come on. Come on, give God a worship. Give God your thanksgiving. Come on, give him a worship. Give him thanks for sparing your life. I don't deserve it, God, but you rewrote that part.
God rewrote the story. Tonight, as the altar workers that are here would come. Everyone standing everywhere. Everyone standing. That can. I need the altar workers to come. Come. I'm opening up this altar tonight to those who are saying, yes, I'm still in that place of bondage. I'm still in that place where I need God to deliver me. You're saying, preacher, I don't know what this salvation is. You can be baptized in Jesus' name tonight. You can be filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost. I open this altar to you right now. If you need to come, come right now. If you need God to change some things in your life, if you need God to make change a reality in you, come on right now. Come on right now. Come on right now. I need those that are spirit-filled, that are saved, to be praying as God is sending them to the altar tonight. If you need the Holy Ghost, this is your time to come. God saw your issue. He saw your mistake. But He rewrote your story. Before the foundation of the world, He already made means to deliver you and set you free. Come on, you still have time to come. I know the hour is late. If you're still here and need prayer, won't you come tonight? Won't you come tonight? Won't you come? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. The altar is still open for you. There is no way I can live without you. Glory to God. Glory to God. There is no way. There's water for your baptism. If you're here tonight that has not been baptized in Jesus' name, if you have not spoken in other tongues as the Spirit of God giveth the utterance, we open this moment to you right now. Oh, there is no way. Let God change you tonight. Let God save you. Let God renew you. I can go. I can go on. Those of you who know it, sing it tonight. Burdens are burdens are too much, yeah, Lord, for me to bear. There is no way. There is no way I can live without you. Come on, you still have time to come if you need prayer. If you know it, help me sing it. I have tried. I have tried over and over. This is somebody's testimony, but I found there is no way. But there is no other way. There is no other way. There is no way. There is no way. Oh, I can't live without you. Come on, I need you to raise your voice and help me sing that one more time. Oh, I have tried. I have tried over and over. Oh, but there is, there is, There is no other way. Oh, 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 oh. Way. There is no other way. I can live without you. I believe we have a soul for baptism. Now, I know this ain't no apostolic church sounding like that. I need somebody to celebrate the soul that's going for baptism right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what you call a story rewritten. Lord, I wish I had a praise in church. That's what I call a story rewritten. I need somebody to praise God like that was your relative that was going to the water to be baptized in Jesus' name. Oh, somebody praise him. Thank you.